I'm Rod Serling. You're listening to The Zero Hour. Rest your eyes. Exercise your imagination. This week, Bill S. Ballinger's best-selling novel of the pursuit of a damned couple. The Wife of the Red-Haired Man. Starring Patty Duke Astin, John Astin, and Howard Duff. In Elliot Lewis's production of The Zero Hour.
The Mutual Broadcasting System presents The Zero Hour. Sponsored in part by
the makers of Quaker State Motor Oil and National Presto Industries. This is The Zero Hour on Mutual Radio.
Hugh Rohan, supposedly killed in Vietnam, returns after an absence of 7 years to find his wife remarried to Albert Turner. In a confrontation, Rohan, the red-haired man, panics and kills Turner. Mercedes Turner, still in love with Rohan, flees with him. She hurriedly gathers money and her jewels, buys a car, and the two escape New York and drive to Delaware. Two detectives, Williams from the 19th Precinct and Scores from Homicide, are assigned to the case. Williams finds that Mercedes Turner was secretly married to Hugh Rohan before her second unhappy marriage to Albert Turner. However, he doesn't know it was Rohan who shot Turner, nor is he yet aware that the fugitive Rohan even exists.
I drove back to New York late at night after my Connecticut scouting expedition. I found that Mercedes Turner and a young red-haired man named Hugh Rohan had been in love and had gotten married. This confirmed my growing feeling that someone had been with Mercedes Turner when her husband had been murdered. Someone who was with her now as she ran from us. In the morning, Scores was waiting for me with additional medical examiner reports.
Albert Turner was shot with a .32. One shot through the heart.
Anything on that carpet stain?
The one in the living room? It's Turner's blood, all right. So that's where he was shot.
Fingerprints?
Well, someone cleaned up pretty well, the lab boys feel.
You don't say.
Yeah, they lifted prints on Turner, the maid, Mrs. Turner, some unidentifieds. But the doorknob, bar surface, phone, all clean of any prints.
That it?
No, one thing more. They picked up a strand of red hair. Texture indicates it's a man's. Now, Thelma Jordan can't recall any visitor to the apartment who had red hair.
Miss Battles?
Yes?
This is Detective Williams from the New York City Police. I spoke to you yesterday.
Mr. Williams, the paper says murder. You didn't say anything about murder.
Mrs. Battles, tell me. After Mercedes' father annulled her marriage to Hugh Rohan, what happened to Rohan?
The war happened. He went to Vietnam.
And what then?
I don't know. I guess he got killed over there.
Why do you say that?
Because Mercy loved you no matter how her father felt. If she remarried, it was because Hugh Rohan was killed in the war.
All right, Miss Battles. Thank you for your help.
We found a strand of red hair belongs to a ghost.
Yeah, right. The phone yesterday, you said she went to the bank first thing in the morning.
Mm-hmm. Withdrew $4,500 cash. Collected maybe 50 grand in jewels from her safe deposit box. We got a description from the insurance company.
And her mink coat, another $8,000 or $9,000?
Yeah, probably.
All right, send a description of the jewelry to all jewelry stores and pawnbrokers within 2 days' drive of here. And check out the sale of every new or used car within a couple of hours' drive from here.
You think she bought a car?
Yes, and I think she's going to start selling her jewels, and I think she's got a red-haired male companion.
The ghost, huh?
Right. I think she's traveling with a ghost.
We woke to clear, sunny skies, and Hugh seemed more cheerful than the night before. I wanted him to tell me more about what he'd said. That he was a convict. An escaped convict. Whenever I tried to ask him, he'd sense what I was about to say and avoid me. After breakfast, we left, drove to Fredericksburg, where we were married. Then we found another small vacation cottage nearly deserted by the season.
You'll tell me what happened when you want to. Or not at all. I love you. I have since the day we met. I always will, no matter what.
Oh, Mercy. Mercy. Look, someday I'll tell you. Someday. But not just now. Not yet.
I'm sorry. I didn't mean to cry on our wedding day.
Well, you did last time.
Yeah, I did. Because I was so happy.
Come on. Let's go inside.
Not yet. I want to drive to the drugstore. What you told me last night. What the police might have found. We have to do something about your red hair.
Yes. Then even if they're looking for two people, it won't be us.
I'll be right back. You wait inside.
I'm not a man who believes in ghosts. I recognize that things happen which can't be explained. And I accept the fact that not everything is written out in capital letters so even a small child will understand. But when the lab finds a single red hair from a male human, then a male human with red hair was in the room where that hair was found. Yet all our information led us to the conclusion that the man in question was dead. But there was still an unexamined part of Mercedes Turner's life. Neighbors named Layton, who lived in the apartment above.
Well, you can imagine our surprise. We'd been up in New Hampshire skiing, and we hadn't heard any news. And then on the way home today, we heard about it on the radio.
How well did you know the Turners?
Oh, casually. You know, you see them in the elevator and say hello, or they get out of a cab you get into.
Mr. Turner was shot Thursday night. I believe you were here in town then.
But yeah, we didn't leave until Friday afternoon.
Well, sometime around midnight. We're not sure the exact time. Did you hear a revolver shot?
My husband's a perfectionist about his hi-fi. We wouldn't have heard anything because this apartment's soundproofed.
Uh-huh. What did you think of the Turners as people, as a couple?
Mrs. Turner is a beautiful woman. I don't know about him.
No?
Polite enough in the hall and lobby, but I never really liked him. Had a feeling he could be pretty unpleasant if he wanted.
On the day of the shooting, or that night, did you see any strangers around the building?
Oh, in New York, everyone's a stranger. How do you remember them?
Only if they're acting suspiciously or someone's different. For instance, last Thursday in this neighborhood, did you see a man with red hair? Real red hair.
Well, yes, I saw him.
What was he doing?
Walking down East Vanders in the rain. That's all, just walking and looking around as if he were searching for an address.
Dying Hugh's hair brown changed his appearance remarkably. But very subtly, his attitude had also begun to change. Perhaps it was because my memories were of a younger, more innocent time. When the future was spread safely before us. Ours for the taking. But by the time we left Fredericksburg, he'd become shifty. Suspicious. I was driving.
Where are we headed?
Richmond, Virginia.
Why did we stay where we were? What was wrong with Fredericksburg?
We can't stay in one place too long, and we're too close to New York, and we need money.
What's needing money got to do with driving to Richmond?
I have to begin selling my jewelry, Hugh. I don't want to do it in the same town where we were married.
You're smart.
I worked, you know, while you were gone. I had a good job before I married Albert. I made decisions. I functioned on an executive level.
Better being stuck with me, is that what you mean?
No, that's not what I mean. I love you. You know that. You must know that. Why else are we together?
We're going to stay together. I'll take care of anyone who comes between us again.
In Richmond, I found a company, the Dixie Jewelers, which bought and sold old jewelry. The man was nice and honest, but I was shocked at what I received for my cluster diamond earrings.
How much did you get?
$600. They were insured for $3,500.
Where are we going now?
You decide. You tell me where you think we should go.
Mexico? We can get into Mexico and live there together. They'd never find us.
Do you speak Spanish?
No.
Well, I don't either. You'd be terribly conspicuous.
Well, then you decide. You pick a place. Just so we're together, that's all I want. That's all that's ever mattered to me. Do you think everything's going to be all right?
Why do you ask? Aren't you sure?
I don't know. I'm no longer sure of anything. Those years and... all those years, they take it away from you.
Police work takes a lot of sweat and a bit of luck. We got our first break because New York, New Jersey, and Connecticut cooperate closely on car information. A woman answering Mercedes Turner's description had bought a used car in Jersey City, Jersey plates. When we checked out the name and address she'd given for transfer of title, we found there was no such person and no such address. A teletype to the Delaware State Bridge Authority brought us further information. A trooper remembered the car because it was driven by a man with flaming red hair. The car had crossed the bridge at the end of the Jersey Turnpike. From there, it might have gone into Delaware, Maryland, or Virginia.
Put out the car description and the Jersey plate numbers.
Good.
So there really is a red-haired man, huh?
No ghost, a real-life person. Hugh Rohan. I checked the registrar at his college.
Annixter?
Right. Got his records. Applied for entrance 1964, pre-med. Excellent grades, high school, Germain, Illinois. Lacking credits in Latin and chemistry, admission denied. Which isn't unusual for students from small-town high schools.
Well, how do you make it up?
Tutoring, usually.
And that's what happened to Rohan, huh?
No, he didn't have the chance. Wasn't in school, so he was eligible for the draft.
Oh, lousy.
Instead of going to Annixter, Rohan went to Vietnam.
We drove all day under a sky the color of gray worsted. Occasionally the wind tore narrow rifts through the overcast for a watery sun to peep through. We stayed that night at a motel. Our room was as impersonal as a rented locker. We tried having a drink to help us forget everything that had happened. It didn't work.
Are you sorry you came?
No. I had to come. You can't be sorry for what had to be.
It's dark out.
Yes. What are you listening for?
Do you believe in extrasensory perception?
I don't know. Sometimes, maybe. But it'd take a lot of proving.
I had a feeling this afternoon, sudden, sort of peculiar, odd, like intuition. A message said, the chase has started. They're looking for a couple.
There's no way you can know that.
Oh, yes. Yes, there is. The cons used to talk about it. I didn't believe it. But I do now.
No. There's no way you know that's true.
It's like telepathy. As if some cop's thoughts are being transmitted to me. Not all the time. Just now and then. Just a little bit. Now and then.
Where are you going?
There's a car parked out there. Michigan plates. I'm going to get rid of our Jersey ones.
Here are the records. And Rohan's prints from his army induction. Disappeared on a patrol in Vietnam in 1965. Missing in action, presumed dead.
We get anything on our wanted flyers?
I think we did, Will. A couple of days before Albert Turner was shot, three cons broke out of Bodo prison in Canada. Now, two of them were recaptured, but one is still at large. And that one's got red hair.
What name?
John Red Cargill. Seaman's papers. 3 to 10 for false passport, illegal entry, and smuggling. He'd served 7 when he split. Cargill's prints match Rohan's.
Picture of Cargill?
Correspondence Bureau received a telephoto copy of him from Montreal. Right here.
Yeah. That's funny. I knew he'd look like this. Good features, clean cut, sensitive mouth, eyes. I could see him in my mind.
Yeah. Guy like that, 7 years in prison. He'd probably crack open pretty easy. But, well, the trouble is, we don't really know if he shot Albert Turner.
Rohan and the Clinton girl were married when they were kids or old men and annulled the marriage. Wait a minute. And the woman's safety deposit was open. But...
what's the matter? What's going on?
This list of contents. Insurance policies, empty silk jewel case, title to co-op. Here we are. Why would she keep an empty envelope?
Oh, probably she didn't bother to throw it out.
Or maybe there was a return address on it.
Who are you calling?
Banners, DA's office. Find out if there's a name and address on that envelope.
We didn't stop again until we reached Kansas City. We had run from the Atlantic to the Midlands. Hugh's mood varied from moment to moment. Sometimes he was cheerful and optimistic, and I had hopes, against my better sense, that perhaps something would work out for us. But then he'd plunge into gloom and despair. And try as I might, I could see no future for us except to run until we were caught. Perhaps he felt the same way in that tiny Kansas City hotel room. Oh, Hugh, please put that gun away.
I need it. Reminds me of prison. What I may need to do so I don't go back there.
You have to get rid of it. It's direct evidence.
I won't let matters get that far. Why did you marry Turner?
I told you why. You were gone so long. I tried to convince myself that I didn't love you anymore. But the moment you came back, it was the same way it had always been. Isn't that enough?
But now you're... what do you think? What are you thinking? That I'm different? That I'm not the same?
We've both changed, darling. I no longer know what you think or feel either. Both of us together... possibly we can make one whole person...
office gave you the name on the empty envelope we'd found in Mercedes Turner's safety deposit box, Sayer and Bates attorneys. I talked to Arnold Bates, a junior partner. He was very cooperative. He told me he'd handled an Enoch Arden decree for Mercedes Clinton against Hugh Rohan not quite 2 years earlier. The marriage had been secret, and Mercedes Clinton Rohan had wanted the decree kept secret. Her father was an old man in poor health, and she hadn't heard from her husband Hugh in 7 years. He was presumed dead.
You mean they were married a second time?
Right. After Lyman Clinton had the first marriage annulled, they were married again secretly, just before Rohan was sent to Vietnam.
Where he goes out on a patrol and disappears.
To service again in a Canadian jail under another name.
Uh-huh. Well, whatever names they use, Will, we got a description, we got his prints, and we know their car. We're going to get him.
Yes, I think we will. Any reports on the jewelry?
Not yet.
Keep after it. They're going to need money.
during the day. For tonight, the temperature for Kansas City and vicinity should dip to 39 degrees. It will be cloudy tomorrow with a chance of snow flurries.
How long are we going to stay here?
Oh, another day or so.
Gotta move on. Get out of the country.
We need money to do that. Hugh, don't the police get reports on pawned articles?
Yeah. So I've heard.
Instead of pawning my things, I'll run an ad in the paper and sell them myself.
That's dangerous.
No, I don't think so. Kansas City is a big place. The police won't pay any attention to a newspaper ad.
And then we'll move on?
Yes. Hugh, I promised I wouldn't ask you about prison, and I'll keep that promise.
I don't want to talk about it.
But we must get out of the country. To do that, we'll need passports.
Well?
Do you know anyone? Someone who could get us passports?
In prison, I knew...
We have to leave the country.
Yeah. Yeah. I know someone who might. But, it's expensive.
We'll get the money. We have to buy passports. I think we've run as far as we can.
Tomorrow at this time, rest your eyes and listen here to this week's continuing study in suspense, The Wife of the Red-Haired Man. I'm Rod Serling. Hugh Rohan has returned after having been missing for 7 years to find his wife, Mercedes, married to Albert Turner. In a confrontation, Rohan panics and kills Turner. Mercedes, still in love with the red-haired man, flees with him, paying for their escape by selling her jewels. As their flight continues, Rohan subtly changes, losing his assurance, his confidence, even much of his ability to make decisions. Assigned to the case are two New York City detectives, Scores of Homicide, and Williams of the 19th Precinct. They have been painstakingly putting together the puzzle of Albert Turner's murder by tracing Mercedes Turner and Hugh Rohan's earlier life. Their trail has taken them from New York to Connecticut to Virginia.
Time is what's needed in police work. Time for lab work, time to check out clues, time to find witnesses. It's time to get replies to the hundreds of flyers that are put out to locate stolen or missing property. 2 weeks after Albert Turner's murder, the Missing Property Bureau called me regarding a batch of jewelry bought by a New York wholesaler. One of the items was a pair of diamond cluster earrings sold to the New York outfit by a shop in Richmond, Virginia. The earrings were those described by the insurance company as belonging to Mercedes Turner, part of the jewelry she'd taken from her safe deposit box the morning after her husband's murder. I flew down to Richmond to talk to a man named Town, who bought the earrings from the Turner woman. If you'd look at this sketch, please, Mr. Town. Does the woman seem familiar to you?
Yes, sir, it looks like her, sort of. But, you know, the first gentleman I talked to in New York mentioned the name Turner. The lady I wrote out a check to was a Mrs. Brewer.
As soon as the check clears, I'd like a copy of her endorsement. Compare it with our suspect's handwriting. Make sure we've got the right person.
All right. I'd be pleased to help you.
How'd the lady react to the money you gave her?
Was she disappointed, you suggested?
Mm-hmm.
She was indeed. But then they always are, you know. Person don't take into account markup and resale prices and so on and so on. She was disappointed, I'd say.
But she accepted your offer.
Oh, yes, yes. We have a good reputation, whether she knew it or not. I offered her a fair price, and after a few minutes of debating with herself, she accepted the check.
Was she alone? Or was there a man with her?
She was alone, sir. If someone was with her, he stayed outside because she was alone.
We stayed in Kansas City while I advertised that my jewelry and mink coat were for sale. Where Hugh had wanted to run, to move constantly. Now, without explanation, he changed and seemed content to stay. Not content, perhaps, but at least no longer argumentative. Then one evening, we were sitting in our room having a drink together, when suddenly he began to talk about what had happened.
Stupid. You see, I always wanted to be a doctor. all my life to help people, not kill them. Well, you know, in a war, you see things. There are things you have to do. Terrible things. Brutal, awful things.
The Army reported you missing in action. Then, after a few years, they told me you were presumed dead.
Well, what happened was, see, this one day, we were out on a search and destroy. I was on one flank, and it was all quiet and pretty. I remember a jet, a passenger jet, Air France, I think, flying overhead, filled with civilians going about their peaceful business. And
what happened that day, honey?
All hell broke loose. I don't know, they must have been waiting for us. I got separated. I couldn't find anyone. The air was black. Men screaming. Did you ever hear a man scream in pain?
No.
You see, it's not that I was yellow, but all that blood and terror, pain. I left there. I just wandered off.
The Army didn't find you?
No way. It was like an animal crawling through the jungle, hiding, afraid for my life. Somehow, I don't know how, I got to the coast, to where the merchant ships were anchored, waiting to get into the harbor and unload. That's where I met Cargill, a merchant seaman on the Java shore, an old tanker. He told me he'd give me his papers and get me a berth on an outgoing freighter to Montreal if I'd help him.
Help him how?
Well, he wanted me to deliver some uncut movies to a fence there. Do you understand? I didn't do it for money, not for anything, except to get away from there and get home, home to you. That's all I wanted. Do you understand?
Yes, Hugh. Of course. But how?
Exactly. How? That's where it all comes apart. I was caught before I made the delivery. Cargill hadn't given me a package of rubies. I was carrying heroin.
Didn't you tell the police?
No. I kept Cargill's papers and shut up. You see, I thought I'd serve my time and not tell anyone, not even you, until it was over. And then we could go away somewhere and I'd take another name, study medicine, and be a doctor the way I always wanted. Look at me, Mercy.
Yes, dear.
Is it too late?
I don't know.
You don't blame me?
No.
In New Orleans, there's a man who can get us passports, but it's expensive.
We'll sell more jewelry. And someone will buy the coat.
He's after us, you know.
Who?
A cop. I told you, I know when he's onto something. It's like the two of us are connected.
Hugh, he may be after us. We don't know what they found out.
I'm going to paint the car blue. And I'm going to get another set of plates. I'll be back.
Please.
After we recover the earrings, I guess Mercedes Turner would confine future sales to private parties. If she'd been as upset as the jeweler described her over not receiving a retail price for her merchandise, she'd advertise and take her chance on private buyer sales. That would also apply to her fur coat. One thing for sure, they were going to need all the money they could get their hands on to keep running. I judge they might have gone south from Richmond, but figured it was more likely they'd head west to get as far away as possible from New York. I arranged with the Bureau of Information to subscribe to a clipping service covering 18 cities. Places like Louisville, Kansas City, St. Louis, Oklahoma City, through the area where I figured they'd most likely be. We wanted to look in the personal columns of those local newspapers at items for sale. There was a 3-day lag before the first clippings arrived. Scores and I began wading through a box of the stuff.
Oh, boy. Never realized so many people had so much stuff for sale.
Wearing you down, huh?
Well, it's beginning to, Will. Look at this. Watches for sale. Also necklaces, bracelets, pendants, brooches, earrings. Anything your heart desires is from sale, from coast to coast.
And this, mink coat.
Turner woman had a mink coat.
No name or address in the air, just the Jefferson Hotel, Kansas City, room 1417, and the hotel phone number.
You suppose it's them?
Bless area codes. No way you can tell where the devil the call's coming from.
You're nervous, Will.
Yep.
Good morning, Jefferson Hotel.
Room 1417, please.
Will you hold? That line is busy.
Yes, I'll wait.
They ringing?
Yeah, room phone's busy. I'm on hold. Why don't you pick up the extension?
Yeah.
I can ring your party now.
Thank you.
Hello.
Room 1417?
Yes?
You the party offering a mink coat to sale?
No.
There was an ad last Sunday's newspaper advertising a fur coat for sale.
No, I don't know anything about it. I just checked in last night. Sorry.
Oh, I see. Well, get the hotel operator for me again, will you, please?
Yeah, sure.
Operator, may I help you?
Yes, operator. This is the New York police. Who was the party checked out of room 1417 yesterday?
One moment, sir. I'll check that for you.
You think it was them, huh?
Almost sure.
Sir? The party registered as Mr. and Mrs. Y.V. Garfield, North Sneedham Drive, Detroit, Michigan.
Thank you, operator.
Okay, I'll check it out with Detroit.
8-5 and even, they're phony. I'll get some more information from the Kansas City cops.
We stayed longer in Kansas City than we planned. We moved from hotel to hotel, running ads in the paper. And I sold off my jewelry piece by piece. Winter held Missouri in a bleak embrace. The city tried to cheer itself with holiday decorations, strings of lights and vivid displays from the plaza to the downtown area. But the approach of Christmas brought little joy to Hugh or me. It was then that he began to disappear for hours at a time. I assumed he was walking or reading in the library. Anything to be out of that confining hotel room.
You're the store manager?
Your assistant, Davis.
The sign in your window for help?
You need a stock boy, $2 an hour.
I'll take it, Mr. Davis.
What's your name?
Tufts.
All right, Tufts, full or part-time?
Part-time, but as many hours as I can get in.
The stock room's downstairs. Report to the chief clerk. Get a time card, punch in and out. You'll be paid every day.
Thank you, Mr. Davis.
Y.V. Garfield and wife, North Sneedham Drive, Detroit, didn't exist. No such persons, no such address. The KC cops furnished us with a description of the couple which fit, loosely, Rohan and Mercedes Turner, except no red hair. But I'd already figured he'd have dyed it by now. Scores and I brought our chiefs up to date, and an hour later, we were on a plane to Kansas City.
You think he's still there?
Well, if not, we'll pick up the end of the string.
If they have busted out, where do you suppose he might be heading? Well, Mexico?
Oh, she's too smart for Mexico. They'll go out of the country, somewhere they speak English, England, Australia, New Zealand. Well, maybe not England. The cops are too good there.
Hey, I think they still got the same car.
Last we heard was a gray compact, Michigan plates. That might mean something.
What?
In Virginia, they use New Jersey plates. In Kansas City, they have Michigan plates.
Might change again, huh?
Yeah, Kansas City, Missouri, just across the river from Kansas City, Kansas. My hunch is they'll pick Kansas plates.
Less obvious?
Exactly. Mercedes Turner's a cutie. Plenty smart. Not too sure about Rohan.
You really zeroed in on him, didn't you?
From the beginning, before there was any proof, I knew he was there. I just knew what he looked like. A bit how he thinks. He's our best bet.
The weakest?
Yeah. Yeah, put it like that. Rohan's intelligent, but he's emotional. Poor control. He's going to break sooner or later. He's more of a drag than an asset. If Mercedes Turner were all by herself, another story.
Gradually, I sold off the jewelry and we began to accumulate the money we needed to get our passports and arrange for passage out of the country. Hugh, meanwhile, continued to disappear each day. But I must confess that it was easier not having him underfoot in each of those small hotel rooms we occupied.
Well, good morning. Didn't think you were going to show.
Sorry, Mr. Davis.
Christmas is day after tomorrow. I'll be glad.
You said that working here, I can get a 20% discount?
Yes, tops anything in the store. Now, get with it. Restock counter 15 with perfume.
Yes, sir. As soon as I get my job.
We arrived in Kansas City before noon. The local cops gave us plenty of cooperation. We started checking hotels, big and little, good and bad, a million of them. At some of them, they remembered a couple staying a few days, running an ad to sell jewelry, then checking out. At the Jefferson, there was an unclaimed letter for the Garfields from a Mrs. Arms, return address in Kansas City. I went to check it out, but nobody was home. Downtown garages were covered for a 3-year-old gray compact with Michigan or Kansas plates. By then, it was dark. Walking to our hotel, I passed a big super drugstore. I needed some things, went in, walked back toward men's toiletries.
Can I help you?
Yes, I need a shaving kit and some blades.
How about a new electric razor?
No, just blades, cream, aftershave.
Something wrong?
A man over there, by the perfume counter.
From the stockroom.
Has he been here long?
Most of us are extra help for the Christmas rush. Is there anything else?
No, I don't think so. Hey, where'd he go?
Why, back to the stockroom, I guess.
Where? Where's that?
In the basement. Hey, your things! Don't you want them?
A guy just come through here?
Yeah, Tufts, like a rocket in his tail, same as you.
Which way?
The alley.
South now?
Yes.
New Orleans, I guess.
Not directly. Where's the map of Louisiana?
In the glove compartment.
It isn't. Oh, I remember I had it in our room at the hotel.
We'll get another one.
If the policeman had tried to arrest you in the drugstore, what would you have done?
Shot him.
Would that have helped? There'll always be another.
I'll get as many as I can.
Let me see the gun.
Okay, be careful.
How many shots?
7. 1 in the chamber, 6 in the clip.
Hugh, look, a truck stalled up there.
Left his lights on. No one around. He probably went for help.
Stop the car. Get the Nebraska plates.
Okay. Right away.
I'll keep the gun in my purse.
At least I knew Rohan and the Turner woman were in Kansas City. Why had they stayed over? Well, I figured she was still trying to sell more jewelry. I beat it to the newspaper office. They were making out the morning edition. There was an ad, as I expected. Trowbridge Hotel, room number, with a diamond bracelet for sale. When Scores and I got there, we'd missed them by 30 minutes. The local cops and the highway patrol sent out an all-points bulletin. Meanwhile, I went out to see Mrs. Arms, who wrote the unclaimed letter. She was at home now. Pleasant-faced woman, mixed gray and blonde hair, living in a big, comfortable fieldstone house, log burning in the fireplace.
Why, yes, I went down to Mrs. Garfield's room at the hotel. I was interested in the fur coat she wanted to sell.
But you didn't buy it?
No, it was a lovely coat. I made her an offer, but she didn't take it. Well, I came home and thought it over. Later, I tried to call her, but there was no answer. So I dropped her a note offering more.
Mrs. Arms, when you were in the hotel room, did you see anything unusual?
No, nothing. Pieces of luggage, closed, toilet articles on the dresser.
Think, please try to remember. It may not seem important, but anything other than personal items.
Well, now let me see. There was a writing desk, something on it, a red cover, blue and white letters, folded, a map.
Of what, Mrs. Arms? What map?
Let's see. Louisiana.
That's it, Louisiana, New Orleans.
What town is this?
I don't know. How far are we from Kansas City?
About 40 miles.
I'm worried. They must have roadblocks up further down.
We just keep going until we hit them.
No, wait. That bus in front of the cafe. You let me off here, middle of the block.
What for?
I'm catching that bus south. We have to split up here. It's the only way to get through.
Wait a minute.
No. Take this money. Meet me in New Orleans. The old hotel on Tupelo Street. Use the name Graham.
When?
Christmas. Be careful.
You are listening to Mutual's presentation of The Zero Hour.
Tomorrow at this time, rest your eyes and listen here to this week's continuing study in suspense, The Wife of the Red-Haired Man. I'm Rod Serling.
Today's episode brought to you in part by Contact and the makers of Kodak cameras. This is The Zero Hour on Mutual Radio.
You have been listening to The Zero Hour, a presentation of the Mutual Broadcasting System in association with Hollywood Radio Theater, heard every weekday at this time. Rod Serling is your host. Zero Hour is produced and directed by Elliot Lewis. The Hollywood Radio Theater theme was played by Ferranti and Teicher and is now available on United Artists Records and Tapes. Hugh Douglas speaking. Tune in tomorrow and once again,
rest your eyes and listen here
to The Zero Hour.
This is the Mutual Broadcasting System.